welcome to Ghetto Garage. I'll show you what I've been doing. Okay. New bushings. I probably can't see it. No, let me turn some light on for you. There you go. New bushings there. New bushings there. Oh, Lord have mercy. Oh, let me see if you can see it all. Yeah. New bushings there. Let me kill the light. The front. You can't see, really. It's really hard to get this in because they fiberglass the nose. And they didn't put that inner impact bar in. Inner impact bar is... let me see if I can do it like other people do. Where's my finger at, really? Oh, it's over here. It's that black thing right in there. And then you got a fiberglass thing, and then you got this support. These books, Chilton's and Hayes or whatever, you know, they're really not, they're not very informative, put it that way. They don't even tell you how to, they don't even show it in the book, these bushings here, that the support frame extension goes to the nose. They don't show you that. They don't show you how to put the bushings in or even where the bushings are at. I wish I had a shop manual, but I did run it off the internet. Eckler's, they show you how to do it roughly. You got to put shims in the car. I did the best I could. I guess I'll see when I put the tires on, then put the doors on, to see how well everything lines up. Let me kill the, I thought I killed the light here, but I didn't. Some doors, the red door was on here, what do you have, about, what, 5 shims in it? You know, and this was an 80, and the maroon Corvette was 80. But the sad thing is that the situation I'm in is when I put the bushings in the Corvette, Eckler says to keep track of how many shims are in there. Well, I kept track of my maroon vet when I pulled the body bushings out, but this is not the same car. So they tell you to keep track of how many shims are in each corner per se. So, cause they just done it at the factory professional. So this is not professional. So we'll see what happens here. To be honest, I'm not really interested in this car. I really haven't decided what I'm going to do with this car. It's probably sad for me to say, but there's just a lot of things that I've realized that the guy that took this apart apparently lost interest like I did. I don't know. It's overwhelming. I'm going to be honest. This is not a professional shop, and I don't have much resources. And am I using excuses? Hopefully I'm not. I don't know what. I know that if I part this out, I'm going to get nothing. If I put it together, but is it worth the time I put into it? Like maybe the next 4 months, is it worth the time? Because what I see on eBay, they're only pulling... Not counting a motor, but if you have a stock motor, you can buy a Corvette that, you know, moves. Probably needs bushings and everything, but you can get them for like $5,000. What's this going to be worth? Yeah, I know I got 55 in a motor. But anyway, what I've been working on, before I start, I should have listened to Tom's Warner for World. Because I had this plugged in, and I think he's right. I watch this thing come on, then it goes zzz, after about an hour or so, zzz, it gets hot because I believe the glass is in there. I have very bad luck with that. I'm going to tell you this deal in a minute. This is a Craftsman. Here's my snowblower. And apparently this is mine too. I'll explain that in a minute. I've never had a good snowblower. I've always had them used, and this is what happens when you get them used and, you know, they've been abused. The key doesn't work, and, you know, you got it, you know, the carburetor doesn't have a cover on it anymore. I'm not complaining. You know, you have a gas line just hanging in the wind, you know, right over here, and you have to use starting fluid to get it started because all this filter is gone and everything. Then you got horrendous amount of rust, but it worked. She likes to run on high, you know. Anyway, that's why. Where is it at? Oh, I don't know. Where is it at? I must have some starting fluid. Yeah, gotta have starting fluid for it, you know, to get it to start. Okay. Words of wisdom today? Oh, I think I have a few, but I don't know. Anyway, this is the gentleman's down the road. His name is Wayne. I'm not going to show you his house. He lives two houses down. He bought this about 4 years ago. It's a Craftsman 24-inch electric start. He paid like, I don't know, $600 for it. You know, it's got reverse on it. It's pretty nice. I mean, I've never had anything this new. Yeah. So what the deal is, I'll show you what I'm doing to it. The average person doesn't see it, but I do. It's like right here, it started bubbling, you know, because it gets moisture underneath it. And it starts bubbling. And I put rust deadener on it. You know, down on the bottom, especially in the chute. What it had to do is, he had a problem. Really? Is the light not going to work? There we go. He had a problem last year because what would happen is, oh, I probably need the light on again. Let me turn the light on. There we go. Last year, if it wouldn't get blurry on me. Really? Okay. You see where I drilled a hole there in the back of the chute. Because what had happened was water sets in there and it freezes, and he didn't realize that he spun the belt off it when this water freezes down here, that this locks and don't move. So what I'm doing is I'm cleaning all the rust up because this is a really nice snowblower. I want to keep it as brand new as possible. This is what I did all yesterday. I was going to pull all this apart. I wish the thing would stop getting blurry. I was going to pull all this apart, and I tried to a little bit. Then I thought, you know what? You don't need to turn into that. So it made it a lot more difficult to reach down in there with wire wheels and everything. What I'm going to do is I put rust deadener on it, because that's what that is. Most people know what rust deadener is. It's a sulfuric acid, per se, quote unquote, that changes it to rust. You got to take it out as much as possible. And what I do is it's still sticky, per se. It's been a day, but the shop temperature ain't like 60 degrees. Well, this ain't a shop. Ghetto garage ain't 60 degrees. You know, anyway, the story behind this. Okay. Let me go on and get my, oh, it's right there. See if it takes too long to set this thing up. Moon indicator light says it's Turkey Day. Commercial break. Oh, before you carried away about the snowblower, I'm gonna kill these lights. Yeah, save a dollar. Be thankful and grateful for what you have. Because if you're not thankful for what you have in life, may it be good health, prosperity, whatever, God ain't going to give you anything more if you're not grateful for what you have. you kind of turn into like a greedy little person. Anyway, that's just my opinion. Got a little shorter here, huh, boys and girls? Yeah, I cut about 3.5 inches off. Anyway, that snow blower, what is the situation with that is my friend Wayne down the street, he's probably 70-ish, I don't know, and his wife is probably about 70-ish too. They live alone. He had to have electric start because, you know, he can't pull a snow blower over anymore. Anyway, he has had cancer in his throat, and she has had some type of cancer too. And they can't get out in the cold, you know, to snow blow. So they asked me, would I snow blow? I started snow blowing last year, I think once or twice, because they don't need to be out there. I'm young enough. They're supposed to do it. But anyway, they want to give me that snow blower if I would snow blow their sidewalk and stuff and their driveway. Well, not a driveway, but a parking spot. Of course, I'll do that. I do that regardless of mine. And they know my snow blower isn't the greatest, but it would work, you know. Anyway, he wants to give me that snow blower, and I can't take it. It's just here because I want to kill all the rust, and I'm going to paint it with a brush paint with rusty metal oil-based primer, and then I have some Red Devil. Hopefully it'll match. I don't know if it's harder than the can or not, but of some Red Devil oil base, because I think that's pretty durable. No, I'm not going to break it all apart and spray it. I'm trying to preserve it. I'm not trying to make it look beautiful. I'm trying to preserve what's there, because it's a very nice snowblower in my eyes. I ain't never had nothing that nice, you know. I can just imagine when wintertime comes and, you know, this thing runs, idles nice, and things work, and I don't know. I'm thinking about making a cover over the motor. I don't need to, but he says it's mine, and anyway, I'm thinking about making a cover over the motor right here, to cover the motor so snow don't get on it. Do you have to do that? No. I don't know, I want to do that. And I guess that's why I started working on a snowboard, because it's what I want to do right now. I don't want to work on this. Shame on me for saying that, but it's true. Anyway, he wants me to just take a snowblower and keep it and leave it down here, and I told him no. Like I said, I'm going to kill the rust. I'm going to bring it back down there. And I'm going to get my coffee. Another commercial break, okay? Sorry for the video being boring. This is all that's been happening. Mood indicator says, light says rock on. Pretty humbled that he would give me the snowblower. I have a hard time taking it. I told him like maybe in 3 years I'll take it. Maybe. Man. It's too nice for me. He's got a big heart. The reason I'm working on it, because it was new. And I see a lot of cars on the road that are new. And maybe they don't have full coverage on it or something. I don't know. But they'll have a damaged fender. And I think to myself, yeah, I do body work, but why don't they just try to make the dent better? Or if they have a little rust with the paint chips off, why don't they try to sand it and put some kind of spray primer on it or something just to stop it or slow it down? They just run the car. It's funny when I see these cars and like 10 years old or so, I'm thinking somebody bought it brand new. Somebody paid good money for it, and then it kind of turned by and went downhill. I just want the snowblower to last forever because I can. I guess I realized I like making things better than what they were. I don't like to let things go downhill. Words of wisdom, it's like your relationship. Don't let it go downhill. Don't let your cars go downhill. Don't let your house go downhill. You got to maintain it. Sometimes it's overwhelming to maintain everything, but you really have to. Otherwise, it's just wasted money. I know I'm rambling. The vet, really? My heart's not in it. What am I going to do about it? I don't know. I really don't know. Maybe I'm procrastinating. That's why I'm doing the snowblower. I don't know. James Freddie in his video when he was pulling a frame machine, pulling that Mustang out. Oh man, that is, I dig that. I dig that. That's me. All day, every day. Just taking something isn't, I don't want to say unrepairable, but most people don't have the ability. Maybe I shouldn't say that. But have the machinery to pull it out. I love that. I love bringing stuff back that are, it's basically gone too far, and you bring it back and nobody can tell. I don't know why. I love that. I love that when I do body work. I love taking, doing the raw, rough work and cutting the rust out and making it better. And then the finessing, I hate that part. And then I like painting. Anyway, before I ramble on too much, that Tom dude that has that building, he just got his heat fixing in the Velvet's booth. I'm supposed to paint a 68 Roadrunner convertible. It's going to come in on a car. Am I nervous? Yeah. I haven't even seen the car. And the guy, I talked to him on the phone, he's going to use Matrix products. And the blue is transparent. Am I nervous? Yes, because it's a high caliber car, a 68 Roadrunner. It seems like it's going to happen. We'll see. Maybe this week or something, if I go down there, I'll make a video of the booth. The booth is really cool, man. It's heated. You know, the air comes in from outside, and it's killer, man. It's killer. It's better than my booth. Anyway, Meredith, be thankful for what you have. And you know, I used to think that long as the exterior was good in my inner body, if I had a choice between looking good or feeling good, I always said I would pick looking good. And that's so wrong as the older I get, because if your mind ain't right, and your spirit ain't right, and your health ain't right, what good is the exterior? Exterior is just a shell. I'd rather feel good inside, because especially if this controls everything. If this ain't right, it's not going to make these move. And if you don't have your health, I see there. I guess I live in an older neighborhood per se, where a lot of people are getting older, like me having to do the snowblower. And I'm humbled that he would trust me with it. Bottom line is, be grateful for what you have. Let me go on and do the peace segment, call it even. You guys have a nice turkey day. Peace of mind. Peace of oneself. Peace on earth. Bigger piece of the pie. Piece of the action. Piece of pussy. Internal peace. My place in heaven. And when the big dogs are all done eating, even the puppies get a piece of something, motherfucker. This is a proven fact that the guys, and I'm not even saying I'm even one of the guys in the circle, but helping everybody else out, isn't that what America's all about, man? Really? Fight with each other? Everybody has a good side and bad side, even do I do. You guys have seen it. Try to be positive. I'm not the most positive person. You know, you can only have one thought in your mind. Either it's positive or negative. There's always a good side to everybody, man. Always. Just look for it. It's like being married. It's give or take, man. You can't have the way all the time. Otherwise, you're going to be lonely by yourself. I think I'm done, people. Gobble, gobble. Peace, people.